If you will, go ahead and turn to Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, then I'm going to go to Hebrews after that and maybe read a verse or two. Yeah. Romans chapter 8. A few thoughts have been on my mind since really about last Sunday or this Monday, I guess. I had it on my mind, hadn't really studied nothing out on it. It seemed like the more that was said and done, the more it kept coming to my mind. But I write some more to read in some of this if I get to it all, and if I don't, that's fine. But it's pretty serious scripture in the Bible on who you belong to. They ain't, but we all belong to somebody as far as on this earth, and as far as our family and our father and mother, and you belong to a certain group or a certain lineage, I guess you could say, and the Bible that you belong spiritually to somebody, and I want to read this, and maybe this will help somebody this morning. I know it helped me to really think about some things. But in Romans chapter 8 and verse 1 says, "There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God, sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And if Christ be in you, and the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But the Spirit of Him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you. He that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by His Spirit that dwelleth in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. For if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the Spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. Yeah. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with Him, that we may be also glorified together." Now, that's a lot of reading to get to one certain point, I know, but it'll make sense if I get to everything I want to read. And like I said, I had on my mind who we belong to. This verse of Scripture on down in here towards the end, verse 14, "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God." And I thought about it a lot this week, and we talked about it some up here at work, and I've talked to two or three people about it this week, about just really knowing who you belong to. And everybody wants to think they're a child of God, and I've thought about it as far as why does God reference us so much in the Word of God, us being His children? And from the beginning to the end of the Bible, it's always references that reference us as the children of God. And I told some of these boys, I got to thinking about it this week, and the way God looks at us, and He compares it to an earthly thing as far as us having fathers on this earth, and Him being our heavenly Father, and us being His children, and I got to thinking, you know, the verse of Scripture on in here I'm going to get to, as far as you have to have a father. You on this earth, to be born, you have to have a father. Well, spiritually, you have to have a father.
Yeah.
And for some people, it ain't God. But I want you to, if you're sitting there this morning and wondering who you belong to, who your heavenly Father is, hopefully the time I'm done, you can really think about it. And I know some of us is already thinking, well, I know I belong to God. Well, I hope you do, but I want you to understand how God looks at us. If you belong to Him, He looks at you as a child. I talked to these boys. I had a good time up here yesterday. I enjoyed that more than anything, talking about the things of God, just the way God views us. And I thought about it this week. I had to endure some chastening from God this week. And I want you to flip real quick over to Hebrews chapter 12. And this is real familiar Scripture. We'll go right along with this, and we might even go back to Romans. I don't know, but just mark it or hold your place there just in case. But Hebrews chapter 12, this right here will really start helping you to decide who your heavenly Father is. This means a lot. This Scripture is real serious, and it's overlooked a whole lot. I know David's preached on it several times, and it's probably been taught on this church, but it's serious. Listen to Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 says, "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witness, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before Him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider Him that endured such contradiction of sinners against Himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. Ye have not resisted unto blood, striving against sin, and ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of Him. For whom the Lord loveth, He chasteneth and scourgeth every son whom He receiveth. If ye endure chastening, God dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the Father chasteneth not? But if ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then ye are bastards and not sons. Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much more rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live?" You see, I've heard this preached on, and I've based my salvation a whole lot of times in times past, whether or not God was dealing with me and chastising me, and He always did. It made no difference what kind of sin I was sinning. He chastised me. Just like it said there, went on to reference a heavenly Father. When I was a youngin' and growing up, it wasn't no problem. If I done something my daddy didn't like or that he told me not to do, he whipped me. And I do the same thing to Carly. If I've told her not to do something, I'll whip her to help her, to correct her. And the reason why, she belongs to me.
Come on. Yeah,
bless you. I'm not going to whip your youngins because they don't belong to me.
Come on.
She belongs to me. She's mine. You see, that's why God references us as the children's son. He looks at you just like that. You belong to Him.
Yeah.
He wants you to do right. That's why I believe that's why these verses is in here. If you endure chastening, God deals with you as with sons. There's a whole lot of times when I got whipped, and I see it now with Carly, she don't like it. It hurts her. Not physically, it hurts her. spirits. You don't like it. You don't want me to be mad at her. And even when I was getting them from my dad, I didn't like it. I didn't want him to be angry. But now that I've grown and I got to thinking about it, and I was telling these boys, the older I got and growing, as in age with my dad, I got to thinking, and I didn't want to disappoint him.
Come on, yeah.
The whipping's hurt a lot less physically the older I got, but the more and more I was growing as a human being and I learned that knowing that my daddy loved me, I did not want to disappoint him.
Come on, bro.
And you think about that as a Christian, if you sit here time and time and time again, you're supposed to be growing as a Christian.
Yeah.
I believe it disappoints God more and more and more. You sit here this whole time.
Amen.
And you still want to go out here to sin and mess. I thought about it Wednesday. I'm not going to call it messing up no more.
Amen.
It's not messing up. It's sin. Sin is sin. It makes no difference what we do. It's sin. It disappoints God because He looks at us as children.
Come on, see you all.
I thought long and hard about it this week. I love my earthly daddy. I thank God for him. I don't believe I'd be here today if it wasn't for him taking me to church and growing up in church life. I don't. I know he loves me. And you need to realize God loves you. That's why he don't want you sinning. He don't want you going against this book. You think, I don't know if everybody in here has got a child or not, but you either got a little child you're close to. You think about how much you love him and how much you want the best for them. I want it for Carly. I want her to do right. I want her to be safe all the time. I don't want no harm coming to her. I want her to listen to me because I believe I know what's best for her. Same way with God.
Yeah, bless him, Lord.
Amen.
And you think as far as you need to look at it as growing spiritually. He's our spiritual father. It's a spiritual thing. It don't matter how old this flesh gets, he still views us as a child. And I was told that from a long time ago that my dad and mom always told me I'd be their young. And I believe that. That's the way God looks at us. But there's a thing about you. You need to understand that the most serious scripture in this right here verse 8 says, "But if ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then ye are bastards and not sons." You don't belong to Him.
Amen.
Just like I said, there's a reason I don't whip somebody else as young as they don't belong to me.
Bless you,
Lord. To me, it's just pretty simple, self-explanatory. You whip your own young as they belong to you. However it works in you, the Father spiritually chastises us. Earthly fathers chastise their young. It's the ones that belong to them. That's what it is. Who do you belong to? Let me go on to John. Turn to John chapter 8.
Bless you, Lord.
Touch it, bro. Teach
it, bro. This right here is working. I'll be honest with you. I honestly thought of reading and studying on this last night and going back over it. Laying there in the bed, I thought, God, this is liable to scare somebody.
Come on, bless him, Lord.
And I honestly thought, you know what, maybe that'd be good.
Come on.
Maybe it's time somebody did get scared. And I don't mean to try to talk you out of your salvation. That ain't what this is about. This is to make you think exactly who do you belong to.
Yeah, bless
you. People's confused, just like what I'm fixing to read you right here. The Jews of this day was confused. And John chapter 8, verse 31 says, "Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if ye continue in my word, then ye are my disciples indeed, and ye shall know the truth. And the truth shall make you free." They answered him, "We be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free?"
Tell it, bro.
Jesus answered them, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is a servant of sin.
Come on.
And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the Son abideth ever. If the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed. I know that ye are Abraham's seed, but ye seek to kill me, because my word hath no place in you. I speak that which I have seen with my father, and ye do that which ye have seen with your father. They answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. Jesus saith unto them, if ye were Abraham's children, ye would do the works of Abraham. But now ye seek to kill me, a man that hath told you the truth, which I have heard of God, this did not Abraham. Ye do the deeds of your father. Then said they to him, we be not born of fornication. We have one father, even God. Jesus said unto them, if God were your father, ye would love me, for I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I of myself, but he sent me. Why do ye not understand my speech, even because ye cannot hear my word? Ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. And because I tell you the truth, ye believe me not. Now, it gets pretty plain and simple now, the way I look at it, that you either belong to God or you belong to the devil. Either your father is God or your father is the devil, plain and simple. No two ways about it, Keith, the way I see it right here reading this Bible.
Come on.
And you say, I knew what was going to happen in reading this. Everybody sitting there thinking, I don't belong to the devil. I'm sitting in church this morning. That ain't how it works. Did you not just listen to that?
Yeah.
If you belong to God, you do the works of God.
Come on. That's the Bible.
Plain and simple. I'm reading this to me. I've struggled with this before. I'm just going to be honest with you. I ain't always done what God wanted me to do. I have purposely went against this Bible, and it hurts. But you got to go back to Hebrews 12 for that. If you endure chastening, you're not a bastard, you're a son. You belong to God.
Amen.
Now, if you're sitting there right now thinking and wondering who you belong to, when you go against this knowing better, does God deal with you?
Come on.
Yeah.
If he don't, according to this, you're a child of the devil.
Come on, tell us.
You say, well, I'm not an evil person. I didn't say he was. According to this Bible, let's just flip real quick.
Bless
while we're on this right here. To 1 John chapter 3.
Here we go.
Bless him,
Lord.
Tell it, brother. Come on.
This will help. I won't even have to say nothing. This will be good right here. First John.
Yeah, come on.
1 John chapter 3. I didn't know how to get to read all this. 1 John.
Really nothing.
1 John chapter 3, verse 1.
Mine's spirit, brother. Go ahead.
1 John chapter 3, verse 1. Says, behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is transgression of the law. And ye know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not.
Come on.
Whosoever sinneth hath not seen him, neither known him. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteousness, even as he is righteousness. He that committeth sin is of the devil.
Come on.
For the devil sinneth from the beginning, and for this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin, because he is born of God. In this the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever doth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. You see, that just gets simpler. The more you read, the more simpler it gets. It's self-explanatory. And you say, well, I told a lie this week. Does that make me a child of the devil? did God deal with you on that particular sin?
Bless him, Lord.
And you say, well, I don't know. Well, I've been thinking about some things this morning.
We put
sin on levels. I don't know why our human mind will put sin on levels. It makes no difference what you've done. It made no difference what I've done for God to deal with me. What it's a saying here is, it's just like David's preached for years and years and years in this church. If you're living in it and continuing in it, you don't belong to God.
Amen.
You can't. It ain't just that you don't belong to God. You can't keep doing it.
Come on.
Yeah.
God's dealt with me on some things here in the last year or so. And I've had to repent. I've had to pray, ask forgiveness on things. I got mad here several months ago. I mean, just fighting mad. I would love to just hit somebody out of mad. And the more I got to thinking about it, the sicker I got to my stomach. I didn't like feeling that way. And I felt like that just on something that simple. And now if I do sin, it's bad. It turns my insides up, Jeff. I can't stand it. It bothers me.
Come on.
Yeah, bless you, Lord.
And it goes right back to me, because I belong to God. God looks at me as His child, considers me His child, wants me to go by this book, and when I go against it, He will correct me.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
And I'll say this, it don't always have to be. That's very important. Know that God's dealing with you on things when you sin. That's an important thing to know in your life.
Amen.
It don't always have to be a whip. I don't always take a belt to Carla. Sometimes all I got to do is look at her. Sometimes all I got to do is just my feet hit the floor. And she knows. And you say, well, what's that mean with God? God's going to deal with you in certain ways and different ways. But He's going to deal with you for sure. One way or the other.
Amen.
You'll know it. You can't be a child of God and not know it.
Yeah.
That's just like Brother Buck sees Carly doing something and gets on to her. She might not take him as serious as she would me. That ain't her daddy. I am.
Come on.
Same way with God. It's a serious thing to God. It ought to be serious to us.
Amen.
When God goes to dealing with us. If He's a dealing with us. You see, I thought about that. It ought to scare somebody this morning to death to know that that God considers you a child of the devil. To me, I don't know how much more serious is it going to get for God to look at you and say, that's not mine. That's a child of the devil.
But you know, brother, the record has already been written down.
And
the word is what we're judged by every day. The word is what calls you the child of the devil. And if you believe this word, then how powerful something that's invisible is. Think about it. The greatest whipping I've ever had from God was the shame of knowing that I let God down.
Amen.
Something that you can't see. Something, amen, that people don't understand. People can't understand how you can serve a God that you can't see. But they don't understand the breath of the Lord is what's moving these trees out there.
That's right. Amen.
You can't see that wind, but there's still evidence that there's something moving. Can I get an amen?
That's right.
You see, there's evidence in people's life that when you're convicted of sin, praise God, this is what God said. You said, and I had a prayer on my heart this morning. It went right along with everything that's been said.
Bless
we need to pray for one another that as parents and adults of this church, that we can lead these children, praise God, in God's way. Amen. You know what God said? You're talking about Father. He said that He will lead us in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake.
Amen.
Praise God. The Word of God is a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my pathway, according to the Word of God. That's the Bible. Amen. We're led every day by God Almighty by this.
Right.
But you've got to make a choice.
Amen.
You want to live like the world, you live like the world. But don't expect to be a child of God if you want to live like like hell. For the Bible said, they that do evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest their deeds be reproved. That's the word of God.
Amen.
Can I get an amen?
Amen?
Lord have mercy. This thing's getting good. You know what? I was fixing to read what you read in John. Amen.
Yeah.
Jesus told them who they was. If you're a child of God, you'll do the works of God.
Amen.
If you love God, you'll bring honor to the Father. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Your life will glorify the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And if it don't, you'll be ashamed of it. Now I'm not saying you just jump out of, amen, being born again and be some super saint. You've got to grow in the grace and the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. These things in your life coming down through time that God will tell you is wrong, and you've got to get it out of the way. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Being whipped of God is not a shame, amen. Staying in it's a shame.
Amen.
Can I get
Lord?
People won't repent because they're not ashamed of it.
Amen.
They're not sorry of it.
Amen.
The Bible said godly sorrow worketh repentance. When you're sorry way down in here, you'll change.
Amen.
When it gets to where it hurts, you'll change.
Amen.
Can I get an amen?
Amen.
When it gets to where it costs you everything in your life that you love, you'll change.
Amen.
You see, that's godly sorrow. But worldly sorrow bringeth death. People's sorry because they got caught, but you know what happens just right when the preacher turns his back, they're right back in it. You see, that's worldly sorrow, Jeff. Godly sorrow is when God touches you and the preacher don't have to worry about you because he's got you. You see, I don't have to worry about Lacey Purr. You know why? I don't care if you're a million miles away. There's an all-seeing eye that sees Lacey Purr. I don't have to call him and check on him every 10 minutes. You know why? Because, amen, praise God, God's got a hold of him. And God tells him when he does wrong. Huh? You see, that's the way it works. All I'm supposed to do is catch a fish. I ain't supposed to keep them and clean them, amen. God does the cleaning. I catch them, God cleans them, and he takes care of them.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God, read the book.
Amen.
But it gets down to the day and time, and we're taught by man this day and time we live, oh, that everybody is fallible. Everybody makes mistakes. Everybody. You can't live perfect, Buck.
Amen.
That's what they'll tell you. Oh, you sin, don't worry about it. God understands.
Listen.
God knows every, even the intents of our mind.
Amen.
God knows every hair that's numbered upon
Amen.
Your head.
Yep.
God knows all about you. Your life's an open book before God. But I'm going to tell you right now, whitewashing sin won't get you there.
Amen.
The Bible said, amen, Jesus told them, said you're a painted sepulchre full of dead men's bones.
Yeah.
He said, praise God. He said, you're white on the outside, but on the inside you're dead. He said, clean the inside of the cup and platter first, that the outside might be clean also. He told them, Pharisees and hypocrites standing in the door, and neither will they come in nor let nobody else in. Praise God. Let me tell you something. A child of God wants to live for God. Can I get an amen? They want to please God. They yearn to feel the hands of God around them. Amen. They want to be blessed by God.
Amen.
Yeah. Oh, I felt that. You better look at it. It's some of the strongest teaching I've ever heard in my life. I've heard a lot of men stand and teach.
Yeah,
it's the strongest thing I've ever heard. Praise God, people need to know.
Amen.
People need to know you cannot live in sin. Over in the book, amen, he's told him, he said, how can we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? He said, God forbid. He said, should we remain in sin that grace may abound? He said, God forbid. Huh? He goes on over and he says, if you're a new creature, all things new.
Yeah.
Huh? You see, I was an alcoholic. I was lost without God. But sister, one Friday night, amen, that alcoholic died on the altar, and the man that got up was a new creature. Amen.
Amen.
You see, when I got up, I had no desire to go back to the liquor bottle, and there ain't nobody in this world liked it no better than I did. Can I get an amen? Praise God, I'm preaching to you salvation, not religion. Religion will keep you 2 weeks at a time and let you down. Can I get an amen? Religion, when the cravings of the things of life, amen, comes along, there'll be somebody come by and say, I'll take you a little bit. Amen, get you a little meth, it'll help your nerve. Smoke you a little weed, if you're nervous, amen, one jaw won't hurt you. That's what the world's a teaching. But Jesus said, with all temptation, I made a way of escape. Can I get an amen? Praise God, when I'm tempted, Jesus takes it, amen. You smoke a little weed, you still a dope head.
Amen.
You still puffing on a meth pipe, you're still a meth addict.
Amen.
You still drinking a beer a week, you're still a drunk. Can I get a amen? Come on!
Feel him up, Lord.
Amen. I preach, Lord. Yeah, I love you. Tell you how I stand. You see, this is real. This is what's real.
Amen.
This is not a game. You see these people that's in religion, you don't know how to take them. They'll shake your hand, hug your neck on Sunday morning, and cut your throat on Monday. Can I get an amen? But a true child of God will love you in the hard times. They'll help you up. They'll pick you up, wipe you off. You know what the Bible said? The Bible said, if we see a brother overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, to restore such a one, lest ye sell. Amen. Be fall into the same temptation. Let me tell you something. A child of God will be different. Amen.
Yeah, bless you, Lord.
They'll tell you the truth. If it hurts your feelings, praise God, they'll help you with it. Come on.
Amen.
I get excited. This is salvation. This boy's a teacher.
Amen.
It ain't religion. I'm not religious.
Bless you, God.
Somebody asked me the other day, said, I get this question. Are you a Baptist preacher? I said, no. Ain't no Baptist preacher. So what kind of preacher are you? I said, I'm a God-called preacher.
Amen.
I preach at a Baptist church by choice. That's my choice. But praise God, I didn't choose to preach. God Almighty called me and said, you go preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And He said, you go into all the world and preach the gospel to all the living creatures. Amen. You ought to be in my barn some nights when that old horse catches it. Amen. Woo! Tell him about a God that's able to take the buck out of him. Lay hands on him. Amen. And I pray that God will give him a right mind. Woo! Just let me get on board. I'll ride him. Amen. For your glory. Woo! Oh, I felt that. You better look down. Woo! Yeah. I ain't nothing. Never have been nothing. You see, you got to grow in this thing. Well, God said, get you that. Throw it out of the way. Lay aside every sin and weight that so easily besets us. Let us run this race with patience. If you have been in church Wednesday night, you have got to hear about the spirits of God and the devil.
Amen.
So to try the spirits to see if it be of God. That's what you're talking about.
Amen.
The spirit of the devil will cause you to lie.
Yeah.
He'll cause you to whisper.
Amen.
Amen. Apostle Paul began to preach to the people, and he said today's a constant warfare. You know what it was a warfare against? Good and evil. The flesh against the spirit. It's contrary to one another. You see, when the God wants you to do something in the flesh, is not with it. Huh? Or your mind begins to fight and dread.
Yeah.
Lord, God. I love you. I'm going to try to hush. I get excited. I don't know why everybody don't get excited. This thing tires me up. I'm going to tell you right now. I'm not religious. I'm saved.
Amen.
I'm not perfect. I'm forgiven.
Amen.
Come on, praise God. When I fall and I fail, Jeff, praise God. Any other time, amen, back years ago, I'd have blown up and beat the head off that tractor. Amen. Every time I turned around, praise God, something tore up. Made one
one swipe around the hayfield. Had to call Jeff and him, get him out of the hayfield to press Barron's back into this mower, amen. Where I back to mowing, amen, and praise God, one of the disc heads blew plumb off of me. Amen, I looked around the field, had a mow call. Mow off, Lacey, praise God, hey, standing up, he wasn't even tough. You know what I done? I thought, well, praise God, I can't change that. I just pulled over about a foot and a half, went to mowing 3 foot at a time. I just kept a pecking. Can I get a amen? Some of it don't look so good, but praise God, I got her in the barn. Can I get an amen? Come on, praise God.
I said, Lord, just give me the middle of the fix. Got to kick the hay and the hay kicker flew all to pieces.
Bless him. Bless him.
Hooked up to the baler, praise God, hay dried and the spring broke in. Got on the tractor bell, 16 bells, and his power steering pump gasket blowed out. Thank God for old people. Not that Billy Joe and Keith is much older than me, but praise God. I didn't have a ratchet. I had sockets, didn't even have a ratchet. Boy, that's a young bunch, ain't it? So I called Billy Joe. He brought me. Praise God, amen. Matter of fact, I got your pocket knife, brother. I didn't steal it. Amen. I had to borrow his pocket knife. Didn't have a pocket. Lord have mercy. I got that thing off. Praise God, amen. And just trusted God, Jeff. Brother Keith said, we used to make gaskets out of a cereal box. Amen. We didn't have a cereal box. We had a rich cracker box. Amen. You know what I done? I went home. I thank God. Amen. I cut that thing out. Punched some holes in it. Went back, put it on, finished baling. Amen. Started loading the hay in the barn yesterday. A hose blowed out. I done parked her in, went on to town, eat dinner, got us a hose, come back. Praise God, fellowship with people that I loved. Amen. Men need babies, played on a hay bale. Amen. About 10 or 11 o'clock last night. I don't even know what time we come in the barn. Had such a time, amen, we wouldn't have had that. Amen. If God hadn't have slowed me down.
Amen.
You see, the biggest part of the time, God ain't just slapping you down whenever you're being chastised. It's when you know you've done wrong and God wraps them big arms of love around you.
Yeah, amen. That's right.
When you're expecting just to be thrashed, amen, God hugs you up and says, don't do it again, I love you. It'll be okay. I'm going to help you through this. I'm going to get you through it. I'm going to teach you how to stand and how to walk, Jerry. Amen. He taught you how to be a Sunday school teacher, didn't he? I remember the business meeting when they, amen, loaded you in for a Sunday school teacher. You tried every way in this world under the sun to get out of it. I saw the fear in your eyes. Amen. But you're the face God showed me. Amen. You had to grow, didn't you? Amen. I had to begin to read and study these. Amen. And start listening to God. He'll lead you to stand, amen. Can I get an amen, honey? We don't all just learn right off the bat, it's growing.
That's right.
You know, before long, God don't have to tell you you've done wrong.
That's right.
The minute you do it, you feel the shame.
Amen.
You see, that's chastisement of the Spirit of God. You feel the shame.
Amen.
It makes you sick in here. Nobody has to tell you.
That's right.
I don't know about you, but my wife will tell you that I'm telling you the truth. I'm the world's worst. I may be wrong, but I don't want you to tell me I'm wrong. Amen. She'll tell you. I'm telling the truth. She'll tell you I'm telling you the truth. She never fails to remind me, but praise God, I don't like it, okay? And you don't like it either. Let's be honest. We'll be wrong, know we're wrong, and we do not. Makes us mad as a bull, somebody tells us. You see, that's nature. That's flesh. When we know we're ashamed that we've done wrong. We know we failed. Come on.
Amen.
Failing's what hurts.
That's right.
I didn't mean to interrupt you, brother. No, I love you. But you better figure out who you belong to. You know, he said if you was the son of Abraham, you'd do the works of Abraham. What fruits have you got in your life? These evidence if you belong to God.
You see, I preached in many places, and they, some preachers took me out of mine to church one night and told me I was causing people to doubt their salvation. I said, no, what I'm a preaching, praise God, to let you know for sure you're saved.
Amen.
You got to get an amen? Them that ain't sure of it ain't got it.
Right.
Come on, say, preacher, I wonder all the time. Well, make sure. The Bible said to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Make your peace calling and election sure.
Amen.
When you fail, repent.
Amen.
The way that God wears the high hump, just repent. And let me, can I say this before I hush? Can I say this? Can I say this to you people? Now, I want you to listen to me. Child of God, you may be trying your best to live for God, and things still go wrong. That don't mean you're doing bad. Just because things go bad in your life don't mean, praise God, that you've done wrong. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Maybe God's using you to let your family see and know that you belong to Him. You see, Job hadn't done nothing. Amen. Whenever God told the devil, said, if you considered my servant Job a just and an upright man, eschewed evil, amen, praise God. He said, if you'll take the hedge you got around Job down, he said, I'll have him to curse you in vain. God said, you can have all he's got, but you can't touch his life. Can I get an amen? Job lost it all. It wasn't because Job had sinned. It was because God had his hand on him and he wanted the world to know that God had him and he belonged to him.
Amen.
Sometimes I believe God tries just to see how we're going to act.
Amen.
So he can train us to act right.
That's right.
See, it's training when you bring these kids up. That's like Sally's telling me about riding that bicycle. Ain't so much come to my mind. I tell you. See, they're trying to ride her bicycle with her training wheels. Amen. They're trying to talk her out of. She showed her how she could ride a bicycle. It wasn't 5 minutes. Took her wheels off and began to ride, Randy. You know what? We're teaching them how to ride and how to trust. She had, that was her safety net, the training wheels. But her mama, amen, give her hope in something that you couldn't see. The training wheels is gone, but the balance came. Can I get an amen? Praise be to God. And Grandpa run along with her, didn't you, Billy Joe? Praise God. Hallelujah. You see, we're going to have to walk it with them, talk it with them, help them when they fail. And when we fail, we're going to have to pick one another up and say, devil, that's my brother. That's my sister. We are the household of faith. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Oh, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. I'll help that. Amen. Sometimes us as children of God, we just got to take the training wheels off and trust the hands that's got us. I've learned more from these old horses out in the barn that I've ever learned in my life, Jeff. I'm to the age now that I'm not as rambunctious as I used to be. I respect them a whole lot more, Joe, than I used to, amen. Years ago, I tried just to see if it could happen, amen. I just didn't care. The ground didn't hurt near as bad. Amen. It seemed like I could just bounce up. Now if I hit the ground, praise God, everything's broke. Don't quit. You get back down there. I'm gonna, we got all day here. No, get back down there. No, get back down there. You ain't done. I'm going to tell this. I'm going to run. I've got to where I dread them anymore. I dread hitting the ground. I dread the thoughts of hitting the ground. The devil tells me all the time. He said, you're going to get throat. You're going to get hurt. You're going to do this. You're going to do that. Be crippled up. You can't do nothing anyway. You're going to be crippled. Hey man, there's a little horse in my barn God sent me. Now I know God sent me because God told me I could have it. And every once in a while he'll get rambunctious and he'll buck as hard as anything I ever sat on. It's been a long time since I sat on anything like that. Usually a young horse will stop long enough to catch his breath and you step off and correct it, amen. This one don't catch his breath. He won't quit. So I pray real hard. And I know God give him, so I know God's going to let me ride him. no matter how hard he bucks, no matter how, and that's trusting God. You see, I'm learning, I've got to learn just to go on, no matter what God says.
We think we know it, but sometimes we have to prove it by God's word.
Amen.
But you've done some, get down there and finish it, man. I'm going to hug. Praise God, I'm going to try not to interrupt you anymore, bro. Praise God, you go ahead. I'm excited. I can't understand.
I want to go back and read one place there in Romans, David. While he's talking, brought it to my mind. Where we's at, Romans chapter 8, just a few verses, and this brought to my mind him talking and preaching right then. Verse 14 says, "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God, and if children, then heirs, and heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with Him, that we may be also glorified together." Talking about youngins and stuff, and I thought, I had this thought last night and hadn't come back till David was preaching, and you know, we're born into sin in this flesh. When we're born into this world, it's automatically you start sinning from a young age. It just comes natural. And I got to thinking about last night this verse of scripture here that the spirit of adoption. You know, you can go down here to Ebenezer's Children's Home in Wilkesboro. Come on. You can adopt a child that was not physically born to you.
Come on.
And you can give that child your last name, and you can give that child everything you've got, and leave it, everything you've got, land, money, houses, and everything. And by law, that youngin is yours.
Come on.
Same way with God. If you're a child of the devil this morning, and you're living your life for the devil, God would like to adopt you this morning.
Amen. Yeah. Hey, come on, brother.
He would like to give you everything He's got.
Yeah.
And the verse of scripture, and you don't have to flip to it. Isaiah 56 and 5 says, "Even unto them will I give in mine house and within my walls a place and a name better than that of sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off."
Yeah, amen.
You see, when you're born of God and you're adopted by God, it's forever. That's how serious it is. If you go adopt a child on this earth, it's yours forever. Your mind ought to consider it yours, just like the law considers it yours. I got to think about that. Maybe some of you are sitting there waiting to be adopted this morning. My God.
Come on,
he'll have you.
Aye, aye,
I promise you that.
Amen.
And I was talking, I don't know who it was we was talking to the other day about Ebenezer. You go down there and look at them youngins, and they're wanting somebody to take them. Just wanting somebody to get them out of there and give them a life. Because the majority of them come from a bad situation. You may be in a bad situation this morning spiritually. And I'm begging somebody to come by and help you. Well, God's a door. I believe God done that this morning. Maybe you missed it. Maybe you need another opportunity. I wouldn't pass it up. And when me and Michelle was adoring the host family to getting them youngins, I wanted to give them everything. We took them and done things with them. Tried our best to give them just everything they wanted. Same way with God this morning.
Yeah.
If you'll just come to Him and let Him adopt you and live your life for Him. But like I say, that's a serious thought on who you belong to.
Amen.
I believe it's worth every one of us thinking about it. Just
amen.
To
be on who you belong to. Bro.
But I'm done, preacher.
Go ahead.
I'm done.
Thank you. Thank you.
Just a couple announcements. This Saturday will be our business meeting.
Elections, too.
Elections, month of June. And Bliss, do you have about the Father's Day?
I have several announcements. We have coats hanging downstairs as you go out. People have donated them, and we're just, the basement is so damp, we need to move them on. If anybody knows of somebody that will need a coat next winter, there's adults and children's hanging down there. Please take them, and if they're not taken in the next couple of weeks, we're going to donate them somewhere else that can be used. We have old songbooks that we boxed up. There's like five different kinds of songbooks. If you know of a church or organization that could use songbooks, we have them boxed up downstairs that we no longer use. The cookout next Sunday, the meal will be at 4 o'clock. It's at the Russ Blevins shelter. That's the middle shelter at Ash Park. And the youth is doing that for the moms and dads. Bring your moms and dads, your grandma, grandpa, whatever you want to do. Come out and eat with us. I've had several people ask if they could bring something, or did we need them to bring something. If you want to bring a side dish, that will be great. We won't turn it away, because I'm sure we'll be needing food. But just bring, if you want to bring a side or something to go with hamburgers and hot dogs, feel free to do so. I have a t-shirt order forms for Bible school. It's our Bible school is Mission Possible, and I'm going to start this notebook around. I put an example of us on there so we'll know how to fill it out. The children's shirts are paid for by the youth, even if they wear adult shirts, so don't be afraid to put down if they're big enough to wear an adult shirt. We will pay for that, and we will ask the adults to pay $10 for those that can afford it. And I'm going to start passing that around. And I think that's all.
City so fair.
His love and the over the sea. He'll hold my hand. As over this river I go, then say, Jesus will be at my side. He'll chill the rough waters when by and by I'm crossing the river so wide. He'll
to you. Anybody. Surely God's been good to somebody.
I want to thank the Lord for saving me and what he does for me and my family every day. And for you know, like putting us in church again, you know, like I said, I couldn't pick a better place I wanted to be. You know, but, I mean, they've been a blessing because of my heart. And when Jerry was up there teaching, you know, and if you're a child of God, you step out wrong, he will step in with you.
Amen.
I'm living proof of it. I mean, you know, I thought I was above everything and above the law and everything else, and look what God did. He got me locked up, put me in jail, slowed me down, stopped me, you know. I tell you, I can't thank him enough for what he did for me. Broke in my eyes, forgive me, patient out of
God. Yeah. You
know, he's been more good to me than I've ever imagined what I deserve, you know. I don't deserve the clothes on my back or the food that I eat, and he gives me a roof over my head. Put clothes on my back, put them around good people, and a good thing even though. Bless you.
Bless you.
It's a long and dusty road. Yeah. said that was me.
new song you sang with the boys and I forgot. He's called Peace to the Rest as well. The Master was nigh. He spoke the words and winds all stood still. Even the waters obeyed His will. He calmed their storm like He will mine. If I just remember that He deep inside. So why should I worry? Why should I fear? When the very same Jesus, He's always so near. He lives in my heart and He hears when I cry. I'll call on His name till the storm passes by. We read in the Bible when He walked with them, brought light to the darkness when the way grew dim. How great it would be to have His footsteps in mine and walk with the Master time. And when trials come and death seems so nigh, I'll call on the Master. I know He'll get there on time. And when sickness comes and my body's in pain, all I'll have to do is call on His name. So why should I worry? Why should I fear? When the very same Jesus, He is always so near. He lives in my heart and He hears when I cry. I'll call on His name till the storm passes by.
Y'all pray just a few minutes.
We got a thought on our mind. You pray just a few minutes, if you will. Turn with me to the book of Joshua. About the third chapter. Been on my mind since early this morning. I thought for sure I'd get to preach this in the funeral, but still on my mind. I can't get it off my mind. Nothing else is there, so I'm going to try to mind the Spirit of God. Everything that's been sung or talked about this morning was either crossing over, leaving this world, being ready. Knowing that you're a child of God or whose child you are. Been taught, been preached, been sung. Amen. Deliverance is in the name of Jesus. And I thought about this thing, and the Bible said that there's an appointment that we're all going to keep. Whether you like it or whether you don't, you know, we fight, we go to the doctors and we try to get well, and We fight for every ounce of breath so we can stay in this world just another day. But the Bible says it's appointed man wants to die, and after this is the judgment. There's an appointment of coming for you, me, our children, for the little babies, for every human being that's in this world when we're going to leave this world. When the body's going to let go of the spirit, and the body's going to lay down, and the spirit's going to go somewhere. So you pray, amen, God being my helper, I want to reach to you. Now, the Bible says over in Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 6 chapter, he begins to talk about a list of people and things that wasn't going to go to heaven. Said it can't go. Amen. That's what he said. He said it can't go. Now, I'm going to read something to you this morning, God being my helper, and I just want to mind the Spirit of God, and I hope you have. Amen. The Bible said over here in Joshua chapter 3, amen, I read about old Joshua standing before the people, and Joshua loved the Lord. I believe that God took him and used him, amen, to lead the people.
Yeah,
I believe God made a martyr out of him and let him. He magnified him among the people,
yeah,
that they might know that God had touched this man to lead him through, amen.
Yeah.
You see, amen, now praise God, all the preachers are as a leader. Amen, they're the shepherd of the sheep. It's in the congregation of God, amen. The under-shepherds, if you'll have it. Jesus Christ is a great shepherd, amen, and he's a shepherd. He laid his life down to die for the sheep. But amen, I'm trying to lead you from here to glory. But old Joshua began to tell the people over there, and how many times you see a rebellious bunch of people. Amen, it's everywhere you go, there's people rebelling against everything. But old Joshua began to tell them in the Word of God, said, choose you this day in whom you'll serve. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Amen. You see, I can't speak for nobody else, because when I stand before God, only account I'm going to give is of Dave Lyalls and why I didn't do what he told me to do. Or praise God, why I done the things he told me not to. Bible said you'll give an account of every deed done in the flesh. That's the Word of God. Praise God, amen. Now listen to me. Praise God, amen. Listen, all you're going to give an account for is the person that you are. Yourself, amen. But when you get past the messages that's been preached, amen, in this church on Sunday and Wednesday mornings, and you face God, God's going to say there's no excuse for you not being ready. Now I'm going to preach. You better listen to me this morning, because I believe without a shadow of doubt, sister, we're in the last moments of time. Amen. We're not no longer in the last days. The children of God walked in the last days. Read it. The men of God preached about the last days. But praise God, I believe the ministers and the men of God this day in time, sister, is a preaching. We're in the last moments of time. Amen. Praise be unto God. The Bible said, when you see all these signs come to pass, he said to look up, for you know that your redemption draweth nigh even at the door. Amen. He said to learn the parable of the fig tree, which he shoots forth her leaves tender on the branch. He said, you know that summer's nigh. Amen. He said, learn that and to know this, that praise God, the things that you're seeing, sister, means that we don't have it. It's a short time. Can I get an amen? Now I'm going to preach a little. The Bible said in the third chapter of the book of Joshua, he said this. He said, and Joshua rose early in the morning, amen, and they removed from Shittim and came to Jordan. Amen. They're fixing to cross the river, brother. Amen. There may be somebody in this church this morning that's fixing to cross over. Say, preacher, you're crazy. This is the way I see things. Every one of us has got just a allotted day in this world. And I'm talking about children. Amen. To the older ones, you don't get to go till God says it's your turn. Can I get an amen? Sister Gail, your mama had us a praying that God would come and get her and take her home. A child of God ready, didn't ready, because she knew where her resting place was. But praise God, she couldn't go till her turn came up to cross the river. Can I get an amen? I thank God for them that was ready to meet Jesus when he called. Praise God. But there's so many, that's the reason that Joshua had to get up early and cry out one more time, be ready, for the Lord's coming.
Amen.
Amen.
Now I want you to listen and see some things. The Bible said, Brother Jerry, he said, amen, praise God, amen. He rose up early, amen, and they lodged there before they passed over. And it came to pass after 3 days, amen, that the officers went through the host. Amen, there was a time space there, you see and understand. I don't know how many years you've been born. I don't know how many years you've been in this thing. I don't even know how many years you were lost or if you're lost today. But I know God's a making people ready. And I believe the last calls are coming. I'll tell you what God told me, and then I'm going to go on to preach. About 3 years ago, I began to pray. And Lacey, I began to wonder what my place was. Amen, in the kingdom of God. And I got earnest with God. And He began to take me over to Matthew 20. Amen, praise God. Where He sent the servants, brother, into the marketplace to hire them into the vineyard. Amen. And praise God, they were standing idle in the marketplace. People just standing around in the marketplace. They wasn't in, they wasn't out. Hey, just taking up space. Can I get an amen? And the men of God went out early. Amen. About the night there, the tent. He went right on down to the all the day. Amen. He went to the 11th hour. Now listen, and I'm going to get to where we're at today. Amen. The Bible said it's the 11th hour, and it was about over. But He sent one more servant down into the marketplace. Now let me tell you what the marketplace is today. It's where men and women that's lost without God can come and trade with Jesus. Amen. They can lay their burdens down and their sinful garments and pick up the righteousness of Christ and be ready to go home. Can I get an amen? Amen. Somebody ought to know what I'm preaching. And I asked God why, Jim. I went down through time and I began to study the men that went out. Amen. I began to study about Joshua and Moses and Abraham and Isaac. Amen. And Jacob and all the men of old and the prophets of God. John. Amen. And Matthew, Mark. Amen. And Luke. And amen. Praise God. Timothy and Peter and all the men of God. Amen. And I couldn't figure out where I fit in. And then I got to reading the Word of God and began to see what time was going on and the signs of what God said. And this is what He told me, brother. He said, I've called you to go back to the last time and ask Him one more time. Would you come one more time? Oh my God! This is the last round, amen. God said it's about over and I've come one more time. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. You see, the men of God that's preaching the Word of God this day, brother. Amen, Brother Tom, Brother Tommy. Praise God, amen. Let me tell you something, amen. Brother Joe, God's called us to bring Him in the last time. The Bible said He went back into the marketplace, and you know what He found? There were still people there that wasn't in. They were standing around idle. And He asked them, said, why stand you here all day idle, amen, in the marketplace? He said, because we've had no man to hire us in. I'm here to tell you that there's a place for you in the kingdom of God. Can I get up, amen? I don't care where you've been, what you've done. I know a God that will save you and give you a place in His kingdom, amen. Jesus told him, I go away to prepare a place, and if I go away, amen, listen to what He said. He said, let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. He said, for in my Father's house are many mansions, and if it were not so, He said, I'd have told you. God's got grace and mercy for every need, amen. And He's got a mansion for every man, woman, boy, and girl, amen.
Amen.
There's a place prepared for somebody. Amen. Now listen to me. The Bible said they was there for 3 days before the priest came out and began to tell them. Amen. Praise God. I don't know how long it's been. You've been here. I don't know. I preached babies' funerals. It wasn't just a few hours old. Amen. Some it wasn't even our old sister. Amen. I don't know why God let them be born. It was for His glory. Amen. But I'm here to tell you, God's been merciful to you and me to keep us around this long. Amen. To give us opportunity to get right with Him and to go home. You see, we think we walk through this life just by coincidence. Brother, it wasn't a coincidence you was born. You was born for the glory of a king, an almighty God, amen. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Let me tell you something. Your life's here to make ready to get to heaven. Can I get an amen?
Lord.
God said to go back one more time and tell the people.
Bless you, Lord.
The 11th hour is here.
Yeah, that's right.
It's about to shut down. You know what I'm listening for, BJ Phipps? It's for the voice of the Lord said, come on home. You know what he told him? He said at the 11th hour, hey man, he said, praise be unto God, call in the servants. Hey man, give them their hire. It's over. They ain't going to be no more preaching, no more walking. Hey man, no more praying. Hey man, praise be unto God. I'm going to a country. You'll hear a lot of singing and a shouting. But there's one thing you'll never hear in glory. That's a preaching of the Word of God. Say, preacher, you're crazy. There'll be no need, Rex. For everyone inside will be whole and sanctified. There'll be, amen, saved folks in that country. Amen, believers who live in that city. Glory to the Lamb of God.
Amen.
I don't say to please God through the foolishness of preaching.
Yeah, amen.
To save them which is lost. Huh?
That's right.
Woo!
Yeah, see, Lord.
I got to preach. I got a funeral to go to. You see, another one passed away. Preached his son's funeral about 3 weeks ago. He died this week. Amen. Now tell me God ain't calling them out. Don't you think you could be next? Say, preacher, ain't got a thing wrong with me. I don't care. All God's got to do is call your name and the breath stops in the heart.
Amen.
Amen. You lay down and give up the ghost is what you're going to do. Amen. Amen. You're going to lay this body down and your family's going to do something with it. Can I get an amen? Come on. Say, preacher, you're crazy. You see, when I leave, I don't care what they do with this. Amen. Praise God, amen, because I'm going on. And I'm going to shout the victory, praise God, as I leave. Come on, say, preacher, you're crazy. Now, let me tell you something. The Bible said, amen, now listen. And they commanded the people, saying, when ye see the ark of the covenant of the Lord, your God, and the priests, the Levites bearing it, then ye shall remove from your place and go after it. Amen. Yet there shall be a space between you and it, about 2,000 cubits by measure. Come not near unto it, that ye may know the way which by ye must go, for ye have not passed this way heretofore. I want you to know something, praise God. I'm on a journey home. I know that there's a heaven out there somewhere, but I've never been there, amen. And the walking, I'm a walking. I've never walked in before. Can I get an amen? So therefore, I don't know the way. Amen. Praise God. I have to depend on somebody. Amen. Jesus Christ came. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man cometh unto the Father but by me. Can I get an amen? Jesus Christ came, died, went to glory, sent the Holy Ghost back to get me and you. He marked away Mitchell Poe. Amen. As long as we follow after Jesus, we'll make it. Amen.
Amen.
Too many people's trying to get on their own. They're ahead of Jesus. They're ahead of everything that the Bible says. And they're not going to make it because they're going to get sidetracked. Can I get an amen? I want you to listen to me. The only ones that are going is the ones that's got the blood under the, hey, over the sins. Amen. The Bible said this. Now listen. And Joshua said unto the people, sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. They's getting ready to cross over. Now can I read something to you? And I'm going to try my best to hurry. The Bible said in the 6th chapter of 1 Corinthians, down about the 9th verse, and amen, through the 11th, I want you to listen to something, amen. Now praise God, let me tell you something. Let me read this, then I'll tell you something, amen. The Bible said, amen, the 9th verse. He said, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God, but not that be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor adulterers, nor not adulterers, nor adulterers, nor impotent, nor abusers themselves of mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. Now listen. And the Bible said, and such were some of you. Amen. Past tense. Such were some of you. Amen, but ye are washed. Do we have any washed today? Amen, he said, but ye are sanctified. Do we have any sanctified today? The Bible said, but ye are justified. I'm justified, amen. The Bible said, in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. I want to preach to you this morning. Joshua began to tell them, sanctify yourselves. Change your thing, amen. You don't have to die and go to hell. You can go to heaven, amen. If you'll come to Jesus, you can have life everlasting. Can I get an amen? Amen. Corinthians began to talk about those that were lost, brother. Jamie Hammond, what he used to be. He's a changed man, amen. Sanctified, justified, made alive, amen. A child of God. Hallelujah, praise God. He no longer in prison. He ain't bound down. He's been set free. He's a child of God in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of God. Woo! What they've been preaching and teaching all morning is making a change. Amen. You can go to church all your life and be lost. You can sing I love Jesus all your life and still be lost. Come on. I don't know why this is coming, but it's coming this morning. God showed me things sitting right here. You wait. This Saturday you need to be at the business meeting. Because not only, praise God, are we going to vote on the officers of this church, amen, which is your responsibility. Amen, praise be unto God. Now listen, but we're going to vote on the revival. Amen. I'm going to have God said to tell you, you better be a praying until Saturday night about revival. God done showed me the man that's going to preach our revival, amen. Come on, praise God. Amen. So you better get ready. I want you to listen. You need to be a praying. Amen. Because praise God, this is serious business. God said when we got back, he told me the other day when we got back in this church, amen, to be a praying about revival because he's going to send us one. This morning I was sitting here to come to my mind, Jeff. Amen. Praise be unto God. Amen. Amen. And I believe that we'll pray. Me and you're going to see the same feller. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Amen. I believe it with all my heart. Amen. They're coming. I get ready. Woo! Praise God. Look out. But this message is for somebody in the church this morning. Maybe you tried to do right and things just ain't right. Maybe you're trying to do it on your own and not through Christ. Jesus said, come on. Joshua said, sanctify yourself. For tomorrow the Lord's going to do wonders among you. Today is the day of salvation. Today's the day you need to think about going home.
Amen.
Little do you know, you're going to quit breathing. And when it comes, you ain't going to do nothing about it. The doctors are not going to resuscitate you. Amen, sister. It wasn't no time. You got close. Now God said he's going to leave it with you. Amen, you know what? We're going to see something. You ain't been seeing no prior things you did. Amen, sister, praise God. Don't give up, mama. Amen, God's got you here. You're a witness, amen. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
When the doctors can't figure out why your heart goes back to beating, I can tell you why. Because God's mighty hand goes to pumping that vein. That's better than any machine, praise God, man. Can I get an amen? Come on. Praise God, maybe you've been wanting to pray for a long time. Maybe you've been seeking something, you just don't understand it. Why don't you just believe it? Amen, let God lead you. What have you lost by doing that? Can I get an amen? Say, preacher, I just don't know about this thing. I didn't either. I sure like it now, Jamie. I ain't done. Somebody get you a sermon. I believe God's touched somebody's heart this morning. I'm going to tell you what I believe, and I'm going to tell you what God showed me. I used to be awful bad when God began to move on me and he'd show me things, Jeff. I'd jump right out in the middle of the food line or anywhere. Boy, I couldn't tell. That's where it first got labeled as a nut. They told me at Walmart he was going to lock me up, but he was preaching in Walmart.
They can't do nothing to me till God gets started. They threaten me. They can do whatever they want to you, but they can't touch you till God moves His hand.
Amen.
There's a law officer come to West Jefferson one night. We was preaching on the street of West Jefferson. Amen. We was right out there in the middle of the street. That traffic stopped. One of the young preachers that used to preach with us is out on the middle of the street about to walk on the hoods of the cars. They called law on him. Sheriff's deputy come up to me and he said, "Now you're going to have to get him out of the street." I said, "No, sir." I said, "You're going to have to get him out of the street. Or I ain't touching." He said, "I'm telling you, get him out of the street or I'm going to lock him up." I said, "You ain't going to do nothing till God gets done with him. So praise God, I ain't touching him till God gets done." Can I get an amen? Hey, let me tell you something this morning. Everything right down to the Spirit of God that moved in the house of God this morning, when all God's people began to hear the voice of the Lord and they stepped out and come and eat from God's table, don't tell me you didn't feel it. God said you did. He said to be ready. The Lord's coming. I'm asking you one more time as you pray. Somebody get you some. I ain't gonna linger all day. You preachers have felt it. Everybody in this church has felt the drawing power of God. You people that come and pray, did you feel it? Didn't God call your name? Didn't He just say, "Come on"? Hey man, I've got something for you. You know you was hungry and drink, you come. Hey man, sister, you was hungry. That's the reason you come. Come on, praise God. When you need something from God, you'll come. And I'm telling you right now, by the authority of God's Word, this thing's about over. We're going to give you one more opportunity to come to Jesus. Say, "Preacher, you're crazy." Now, I'm going to tell you, church, I want you to pray real hard. This is a young man on my mind, and I believe, praise God, God's going to send him to preach. We're going to have revival. God said it was coming. Amen, brother. You tell your folks, "Amen, brother, we're going to open a church next Sunday for new members." Amen. They're preaching you crazy. Now, I'm going to tell you what, don't just join this church because God's a moving. Praise God, you better pray about it. If God says join it, we want you to be right in here. But you got to be saved first. Amen. And I'll tell you what I believe. You know what I believe, brother? I believe we're going to get to go to the river of baptized. Amen.
Yeah.
I believe that with all my heart. Get ready for a revival. Get ready for a baptizing. Amen. Yeah. Say, "Preacher, you lost it." I'm going to tell you. I'm going to quit holding back what God showed me. I'm going to tell you what it is. Woo, Lord God, I'm about to spill the beans. You better hold on. Praise God, I got a hug. Come on. Get you a song. Somebody in this church. Amen. God's faith. You felt the hand of God. You felt Him move on you this morning. They saw the moving. And you have a drawing just to come and talk to Him. Maybe you're a child of God. And you know there's nothing wrong. But God just wrung your number and said, "Come on, child. I just want to talk to you a minute. Why don't you come?" Praise God, listen to me. And if it's morning, it's your morning. And God's been dealing with you to get things right in your life. You know what He's talked about? Those that change. Make a change for Jesus this morning. Would you lay your life down and give it to God and walk home with us? Won't you come? I'll tell you what it'll make you. It'll make you a better man. It'll make you a better woman. It'll make you a better wife and a better mama. It'll make you a better daddy and a better husband. It'll make you something that God can be proud of. Would you come? While they're saying this morning, there's somebody to pray with you. How about it this morning? Have you felt God feel bad about it? Come on and pray. Somebody step out right now. Would you come? God said to preach it. Come on. Right now. Don't pass me by, Lord. I read over there when He's walking on the sea, the Bible said He would have passed them by. But they cried out. Amen. I wouldn't want Him to pass me up there.
It feels so good when he touches me. Would you come this morning? Is he calling you? Don't let him pass you by. Come on this morning. You're here this morning because God wants you here. Say, preacher, you're crazy. Identifying the Bible for somebody. Hey, man, come on, praise God. The Lord fires for your soul. Would you come? Have you failed God, child of God? Would you come? He said he still loves you. Let him put it back in order. Come on, praise God. Somebody ain't moved. Somebody ain't moved. You know I'm talking to somebody. Come on. Come on. If today, let me ask you something. If today's the last day, and this world is closed out, God calls and says it's done. Come on home, children. Amen. Come on home. Where would you stand in? You're standing among God's people now. Where would you stand when God calls? Said, I hope I'd go home. It's a no-so salvation. Do you know you would? Let me ask you this. Has things changed in your life since you talked to God? Has it changed? Jamie, it changed. It changed for you, brother. I'm proud of you. I don't get to see you much. Can I tell you this morning, I'm proud of you. I'm proud to walk with you. I need to pray. Well, I wouldn't wait. The next call may be calling you home. The next call that comes may be calling for your heart to quit. The next call that comes, saying we'll cross over, bud. You see, I don't know if I'm going before you or after you. If you go first, I'm planning on preaching. I don't care what you say. Amen. If I go before you do, you go ahead and sing, will you? Amen. Don't wait for an invitation. Bust her loose, brother. Let her go. Amen. Let people know that we love God together. And we're family. And we've gone home. Praise God. Just let them know. Amen. Praise God, can't you feel it? Come on. While these children are praying, some of you, praise God, want to pray. Come help them pray with the shunning. Praise God, let me tell you something. This ain't a game. And Joshua said, sanctify yourself. For on tomorrow, there's going to be wonders among you. God's going to do it, Jeff. Praise God, we're crossing, brother. Listen to me this morning.
There is coming
a day. Listen.
When the heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye, all is peace forevermore. All that happy golden shore, what a day for
here on
what a day that will be.
Praise
when
God.
My Jesus, Jesus I shall see.
Don't teach it to young God. Praise God, give me a long time. Hey God, can you say, man, you can strike the wine today. Praise God, give it all to Him in the name of Jesus. Fathers, we call upon your name, right on the Bible, this child of God. A father today, as she starts a new beginning in life, Lord, I praise you, Lord, for this baby. I ask you, Lord, that you bless her and take her and use her, God. Let her help somebody else in the name of Jesus. Father, today, break your heart, love you.
No more sin. No more parting over there, and forever I will be with you. Bless you. What a day that
you know, we can sing about that day, but get ready to see it's a main important thing. Come on, praise God. Jesus said, I come into the world that the world might know that I can forgive sins. All sins. Can I get an amen? Praise God. Anybody feel the hand of God? Can you feel Him this morning?
My God, I'm just, it feels so good I could fly, brothers. Amen. Feels so good I could fly. My God, amen.
I don't know about everybody else. I'm going to help this baby.
Amen.
I believe God ain't done with her. I believe God's going to use her. You better look out now. Amen. Praise God, brother.
Yeah. Let me tell you something. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Can't understand. I got lunch. We'll be here all night.
I got lunch. I love you. Praise God. I'm going to tell you, I can't make you do right. I can't make you live right. I can't make you do nothing. All I'm required to do is preach you the Word of God.
Amen.
But I'm here to tell you, this is getting down to the last call. I'm getting a crossover, brother.
Amen.
You know, when we get down to Death River and people say you're crazy, the Bible said, amen, yea, you're going to walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I fear no evil, for thou art with me. And thy rod and thy staff, they come with me.
Amen.
Lord God, sister, that's just a shadow.
Amen.
He can't touch you. It has to flee on the Son of God.
Amen.
Lord, thank you, Jesus. Just like the River Jordan had to flee from the priest to carry the Ark of the Covenant. The power of God, amen, was in them men of God. And when they touched the brink of that water, praise God, the Bible said it parted. The children of God crossed over. That's just a shadow. I'm going to hush, praise God. I can preach all day. I feel so good, I can't understand it. Amen. Huh? Come on. It's been a week or so since I felt like preaching. I'm going to hush. Going to pray? Come on. Right now's your time. You see, time, clocks are ticking. Time's running out. Time's running out. Thank you, Jesus. Some of you sisters, come pray with this young man. Come pray with him, honey. God helps you. I know you help her. Come on. Come on. Why people's are touching God. Come on. Do you want to pray? You see, coming to the altar don't mean that you're wrong. It means that you're just wanting to talk to God. Come on. Sometimes I just need guidance. Huh? You can say, what did that preacher do? Whatever you want to do. Praise God. Sometimes I just need help, dude. Amen. Come on. Maybe this morning you just need help. Huh? Come on. Right now. What's holding you back? Is it pride? The Bible said pride cometh before the fall. Don't wait till everything falls apart if God's touching you. Because He's got an answer for you this morning.
Amen.
Amen. Say, preacher, you're crazy. Come on. I've told it many a time. Sometimes God will tell you to take something with you and you leave it at home and then you're in trouble. Because you need just exactly what God told you to take. Come on. God's a touching somebody. Not only this sister, but God's a touching somebody else. Would you come? You need to pray. Come on. Do you need help with something? Huh? Come on. Right now. I can feel it. It's going to get to the place where God's not going to deal with you anymore. Would you come? Come on, while these youngins are praying. Ain't nobody here now. Come on, would you come? I promise you these sisters feel better. This youngin will make it, praise God, another day. Come on. When people look at you and know you failed. Amen. God looks at you and says, I love you. It's going to be okay. I'll make this trial a blessing. Amen. Don't give up this morning. Would you come? Come on. Because I'm here to tell you that God's answering prayers this morning. Anybody know that? Can you feel it? Come on. Praise God. I feel so good. I can't understand. You pray for me this afternoon. You're going to a funeral. It's right after we leave here. I'm going to do my best to hush. I feel like that's what God wanted you to deliver. Well, you're going to get us a song, praise God. We're going to fellowship. And I'd like to say this to Brian and all the men at work. And I appreciate the pride that they put in what they do.